And we can start now.
Thanks, Anand. Hi, everyone. Good afternoon. Welcome to InfoEdge India Limited Q4 21 and full year 2021 financial results call. As a reminder, all participants' line will be in listen-only mode, and there'll be an opportunity for you to ask questions after the presentation concludes. Should you need any assistance during the conference call, please raise your hand on your screen. Please note that this conference is being recorded. Joining us today from the management side, we have Mr. Sanjeev Vikchandani, Founder and Vice Chairman, Mr. Hitesh Ograi, Co-Promoter and Managing Director, and Mr. Chintan Thakkar, Chief Financial Officer. Before we begin today, I would like to remind you that some of the statements made today in today's conference call may be forward-looking in nature and may involve risk and uncertainties. Kindly refer to slide number 2 on investor presentation for detailed disclaimer. Now I would like to hand over the conference to Mr. Hitesh for his opening remarks. Thanks. Thank you, and over to you, Hitesh.
Thank you, Vivek, and good evening and a warm welcome to everyone for our fourth quarter and annual results conference call for FY 2021. As always, we'll start with the overall financials and then cover each business in more detail, and then we'll have Q&A towards the end. The audited financial statements and other schedules on segmental billing, revenues, etc., along with the data sheet, have been uploaded on our website, www.infoedge.in. So let's move on to the standalone financials. Billings in Q4 were rupees 415.7 crores, up 25.2% year on year. FY21 billings stood at rupees 1150.7 crores, down 9.3% year on year. Revenue in Q4 was rupees 290 crores, down 10.2% year on year. FY21 revenue stood at 1098.6 crores, down 13.7% year on year. Operating expenses, excluding depreciation and amortization for the quarter, were rupees 236.8 crores, up by 4.7%. And for FY21, expenses stood at rupees 821.1 crores, down 5.6% year on year. Operating EBITDA for the quarter stood at 53.2 crores versus 96.5 crores last year, a decline of 44.9% year on year. And FY21 operating EBITDA stood at rupees 277.5 crores, down from rupees 402.7 crores last year, a decline of 31.1%. Operating EBITDA margins for the quarter stood at 18.3% compared to 29.9% in Q4 of FY20. For FY21, EBITDA margins stood at 25.3% versus 31.6% last year. Cash EBITDA for the quarter, however, rose sharply by 68.3% year on year to 179.5 crores. Cash EBITDA for the full year stood at 331.6 crores, down 16.6% year on year. Deferred sales revenue stood at rupees 520.8 crores as of 31st March 2021 versus rupees 465.6 crores as of 31st March 2020, an increase of 11.9% year on year. And the cash balance in the IEIL group as a whole stands at rupees 3592 crores as of 31st March 2021, as against rupees 1551 crores as of 31st March 2020. Key snapshots for the quarter. Q4 saw a sharp revival in both in terms of traffic and billing across all our verticals. All our operating verticals did very well in Q4. Billings in the recruitment vertical experienced growth across most industry segments, but led especially by IT and IT-enabled services. The growth in the underlying operating metrics signals a strong revival in the recruitment sort of space. In 99acres, traffic grew handsomely in Q4 across all our categories, residential, commercial, and new launches. However, with the onset of the second COVID wave in Q1 2022, we witnessed a sharp drop in 99acres in terms of traffic in April and May. Since then, the traffic has recovered in the month of June. In Jeevansathi, we continue to invest in brand and marketing and user experience. The higher growth rate in both in terms of volume and value gives us the confidence to continue investing in the business for the next few quarters as well. Shiksha traffic gains over the last 18 months are now getting translated into higher revenue growth. We continue to invest in improving both student engagement through comprehensive both through comprehensive content and more user-centric product offerings. Moving on to the consolidated financial highlights for the quarter. At the consolidated level, the net sales for the group stood at rupees 296.5 crores versus rupees 327.6 crores from the corresponding quarter of March 20. For the consolidated entity, at the total comprehensive income level, there is a gain of rupees 309.4 crores versus rupees 115.2 crores from the corresponding quarter of March 2020. PAT for FY21 at a consolidated level stood at rupees 1408.8 crores versus a loss of rupees 245.7 crores for FY20. This includes an exceptional gain of rupees 1434.2 crores as opposed to a gain of 182 crores last year on account of notional gain arising from fresh infusion by other investors in our JV associate companies such as Zomato and Policy Bazaar, etc. Moving on to business-wise results, we'll first discuss recruitment. In Q4 2021, recruitment segment billings were at rupees 297.9 crores, up by 22% year-on-year, while revenues were rupees 198.6 crores, a decline of 13.9% year-on-year. Operating EBITDA stood at rupees 99.3 crores, down by 24.3% year-on-year. Margins were at 50% versus 56.9% in Q4 of last year. For the full year as a whole, our recruitment billing was down 11.9% to rupees 806.9 crores, while revenue declined by 15% to rupees 771 crores. For the full year, EBITDA margin stood at 55.4% compared to 55.6% in FY20. And cash EBITDA for the quarter, however, in recruitment, for the recruitment business stood at 198.9 crores, up 37% year on year. Naukri had a strong, we saw a strong performance in Q4 in recruitment in Naukri India, with 22% year-on-year YOY growth in billings, with March billings growing at 54% year-on-year. Overall, we saw secular growth with an increase in billings in platform usage and the number of customers across most segments, including IT and ITES and consultants, which together account for over 50% of the Naukri India top line. We saw a sharp upswing in job seeker metrics as well on the platform. New CV registrations per day stood at rupees 16,000 per day, a growth of 25% compared to Q4 of last year. Average CV modifications per day also reached a record high of 512,000, a growth of 21% year on year, and 41% in March 2021. Recruiter engagement with the platform improved further in Q4, majorly led by IT, healthcare, and pharma industries. We redefined our marketing strategy for the quarter with very limited spends as per the current business environment. At the same time, we also managed to maintain our market share of 80% plus in the country's traditional online classified recruitment business. Moving on to iimjobs and Hirist. Not included in the standalone numbers, iimjobs reported a billing of 10.3 crores for Q4 of 2021. This is a growth of 54.9% from Q4 of 2020. For the full year FY21, iimjobs and Hirist added 4,300 new customers, and EBITDA for Q4 21 stood at rupees 1.6 crores, up from a loss of rupees 2.3 crores in Q4 of 2020. And cash EBITDA for Q4 for iimjobs stood at rupees 5.4 crores. And for the full year, cash EBITDA was 6.3 crores. As some of you may already know, we announced and completed the 100% acquisition of Bangalore-based Vayam Digital Private Limited this month, as in June. Zwayam is engaged in business of providing SaaS-based sourcing and screening recruitment solutions and providing end-to-end recruitment solutions with configurable plug-and-play modules. Zwayam revenue for FY21 stood at rupees 6.46 crores for the full year. The acquisition of Zwayam will leverage our strength in distribution and complement and supplement our RMS offerings. Moving on to the real estate vertical, 99 acres. In 99 acres, billings in Q4 stood at rupees 71.7 crores, a growth of 41.5% year-on-year, while revenue stood at 50.1 crores, a decline of 11.1% year-on-year. For FY21, billing was down 13.6% compared to FY20 and closed at 184.8 crores, while revenue declined by 23.8% and we closed the year at 173.8 crores. The operating loss for the quarter stood at rupees 15.6 crores. while EBITDA for the full year stood at a loss of rupees 22.2 crores against a profit of 8.4 crores booked for the last financial year. Cash profit for 99 acres during the quarter, however, was 5.7 crores against a cash loss of rupees 3.8 crores last year. In Q4 and 99 acres, new homes, resale and commercial showed strong sequential business recovery compared to Q3. Rental recovery was a bit muted though. In Q4, our expenses were higher by 20% due to increased brand marketing spends and the launch of a new marketing campaign. Daily fresh owner listings posted on the platform grew 14% year-on-year in Q4. Recovery in broker listings lagged a little behind recovery in owner listings. All India brand top-of-mind share continued to be strong. And traffic in Q4 grew 11% quarter-on-quarter and year-on-year. And our responses on the platform grew at an average of about 35% in Q4 versus Q4 of last year. Responses meaning inquiries to listings. Going forward, we expect the share of online in the overall spend of advertisers and meaning developers and brokers to go up further post the second COVID wave subsiding and lockdowns easing out. As advertisers further realize the inherent cost efficiency of digital versus print media and holdings. Once the lockdown restrictions are fully removed, we expect to see a broader recovery on all fronts, listings, traffic, inquiries, and revenue. Like I said, you know, April and May were for 99 acres were affected because of the lockdown and because of COVID too. Since then, traffic has bounced back in the month of June, but we'll have to wait and see what happens going forward. We continue to invest aggressively in improving our core platform experience in all our businesses, in all our business segments within 99 acres to strengthen our competitive position further. Moving on to the matrimony business, Jeevan Sathi. In Jeevan Sathi, billings grew 12.2% year-on-year in Q4 to rupees 26.7 crores and revenue grew 14.4% year-on-year to rupees 25.9 crores. Operating EBITDA losses stood at 21.4 crores in Q4 of 21, up from a loss of rupees 18.8 crore last year. FY21 billing grew by 15.2% year-on-year to rupees 100.4 crores for the full year, up from rupees 87.1 crores in FY20. And revenue grew to 96.9 crores from 84.7 crores in FY20, an increase of 14.4%. FY21 EBITDA stood at a loss. EBITDA loss stood at rupees 95.6 crores against a loss of 63.2 crores in FY20. Cash loss for Jeevan Sathi during the quarter stood at rupees 21.9 crores, up from a cash loss of 18 crores last year, same quarter. In Q4, growth momentum continued despite a slowdown in March due to rise in COVID cases. The key differentiating features on the platform like online verification, video calling, and video-based online meetups kept driving user engagement, and the app rating on the Google Play Store continued to be one of the best in the category. Jeevan Sathi continues to consolidate its position as it gets into a position of strength in the Hindi-speaking markets. Moving on to education vertical, Shiksha.com. In Q4, billings in Shiksha grew 45.1% year-on-year to 19.4 crores, while revenue grew 16.8% year-on-year to 15.4 crores. In FY21, billing and revenue grew 12.7% and 6.9% respectively, and stood at rupees 58.6 crores and rupees 57 crores respectively. EBITDA stood at rupees 30 lakhs versus the loss of rupees 1.4 crores in Q4 of 20. Full year 21 operating profit stood at rupees 4.1 crores versus a profit of rupees 1.2 crores in FY20. Cash profit for the quarter stood at rupees 4.3 crores, up from a cash loss of 1.2 crores in Q4 20. We are continuously putting more and more efforts to get more and more relevant content on the platform. Talking about our strategic investments, our investee company Zomato has filed a DRHP with SEBI seeking approval for a proposed IPO. Thank you. That's all from us. We are now ready to take any questions that you may have.
Thanks, Hitesh. We'll now begin Q&A session. Anyone who wishes to ask questions may raise your hand on the screen. We'll take your name and announce your turn in the question queue.
Okay, the first question is from Pankaj Kapoor from CLSA. Pankaj, go ahead and ask your question.
Yeah, hi. Thanks for the opportunity. I have two questions. First, on the bookings, especially in the recruitment business, does it also have some element of price increases, or was it all volume-led? And if you can quantify the price component, if there is one. Second, on the cash balance, you still have almost the entire fund that you raised last year from QIP in the books, plus in the next few months, you will probably get another 750 odd crores from Zomato IPO. So how are you thinking about it? Do you plan to keep it for some more time and wait for a larger acquisition, or maybe change the investment style and move for late stage funding? Or are you contemplating maybe even returning it back to the shareholders? Any color on your thought process there will help. Thank you.
Yeah, let me answer your first question. Q4 saw us a broad recovery, in recruitment. We got a lot of new old customers back into the system. Customers who had not renewed earlier. We were, of course, able to upgrade our existing customers also, because recruitment actually picked up in Q4 in a lot of segments. So normally what happens when activity also picks up is that you tend to give lower discounts. So that may have also helped to some extent. Did we take a very aggressive price increase in the quarter? The answer is no. We did roll out some new products for a certain set of customers, but that contribution of that to the growth in Q4 was minimal. To answer your other question on resource allocation and so on, and what we intend to do with the cash, our strategy remains the same. We continue to invest in different sort of parts of our business. The four businesses internally, of course, Naukri is generating a lot of cash, but we continue to invest. We want to invest aggressively going forward in both Jeevan Sathi and 99acres, and if required, in Shiksha as well. We have been making a lot of investments in adjacent areas. We acquired Zwayam, for example, this quarter. We would like to do more such acquisitions going forward in the spaces in which we operate. So that's the second bucket in which we are investing. Because the Info Edge AIF continues to invest aggressively in startups. And yes, we are. We will continue to scout for bigger acquisitions as well. But, there we are likely to acquire maybe one company every two or three years. So we continue to analyze and look at all opportunities in all the spaces we are operating today: jobs, real estate, matrimony, education. And if we find something interesting and which is also available at the right price, then of course we will sort of press forward with it. So to answer your question, the idea right now is not to give cash back to the shareholders, but to utilize it for growth in all the sort of various buckets I mentioned going forward.
The next question is from Pranav Kshatriya from Edelweiss. Pranav, go ahead and ask a question.
Yeah. Thanks for the opportunity. My first question is regarding this pandemic and the phase two of the pandemic. Has there been any impact on Naukri business for non-IT verticals because of this? And for other verticals also, if you want to call out for any specific impact which has happened?
So surprisingly, COVID-2 has had no impact on the overall Naukri business. In fact, we were taken a bit by surprise. It impacted the 99acres business, like I said, because the lockdown meant that, people could not go out to look for houses. But hiring has moved online. Hiring is now all digital. Interviews are happening at home. In fact, it's become easier to hire now because you don't even need to travel for an interview. So COVID-2 has had no impact on Naukri till now. Even job seeker metrics continue to be healthy. Recruiter metrics continue to be healthy. Of course, there was a lull in hiring for some time in between, because maybe there was a point in time when, a lot of recruiters were down with COVID. A lot of, candidates were down with COVID. But on the whole, we've not seen any major impact of COVID-2 on hiring, or at least on our business. Yes, hiring has been mostly IT and ITES led. That part of our those sort of segments or those industries have grew much more rapidly for us than the non-IT sectors, which were impacted a lot more which have been impacted a lot by COVID.
Okay, thank you. That's it from my side.
Yeah, the next question is from Sudhir Guntapalli from ICICI Securities. Sudhir, go ahead and ask your question.
Yeah, thanks, Hitesh. Just want to check if you want to call out any one-offs or so in employee expenses or other expenses during this quarter, because it looks a tad higher than our usual run rate.
Well, you know, we gave an increment to some employees in, I think, the second half of last year. So partly it may be that. And partly, see, we were not expecting, the company to do so well in Q4. So almost all our sales teams met and exceeded their targets. So there was maybe a huge variable payout as well in Q4. So that may be that may have accounted for the part of the increase as well.
So is it fair to understand? Is it a fair understanding that this would have otherwise been spread out over four quarters, and probably it would have gotten accounted for in only one quarter?
Not over four quarters, because see, the salary increase is what it was. I mean, many people in the company got a salary increase, and you know what you saw. I mean, what is there in our results is only the salary increase for that quarter, and also you know the variable payout is also fully for that quarter. It's not as if there was a variable payout which was made for the entire year. But yes, because the way our variable pay plan works is that if you exceed your targets, you end up making a lot of variable. So most people must have made 110, 120, 130% of what the target was. On the other hand, in the previous quarters, because most people ended up doing less than their target, they may have ended up with 70, 60, 80% of what was their targeted variable.
Yeah, may I just add to that, just to help you understand it better? So when COVID first came in March 2020, right, and the economy virtually shut down, we did not let go of any people in April 2020, but we deferred the increments, right? And those increments were given, I think, in December, if I'm not wrong, if I'm correct. But they were not given a retrospective effect. When were they given, Chintan?
December 1st, now we gave.
December 1st, and they were paid prospectively, not retrospectively.
Yeah.
And therefore, that tended to depress the people payouts in the first 9 months of the financial year, because we were unsure what will happen. And when business began to come back, we gave the increments, but prospectively. So the increment that should have happened in April actually happened for some people in December. And for some people, it didn't happen in December. We were being very cautious.
Got it. And Hitesh, just one more question on recruitment. You alluded to the fact that surprisingly, it had no impact on COVID second wave, had not much of an impact in the June quarter also. So is it fair to expect that, we have been seeing a period of depressed white collar hiring in the country for some time now, even before the start of COVID and over the last 12 to 14 months also. So is it fair to expect that we are kind of looking at a strong recovery in the white collar space? And probably one of the green shoots of that is the fact that despite such a lot of panic and fear around second wave, it has not really impacted our March/June quarter things. Is that a fair way to look at it?
Hard to say what is going to happen going forward. But, what I hear from anecdotally from our sales team and what we are seeing in our company also, if there is any indication, hiring in at least of people with digital skills and IT skills is back at the bank. Right? I think the digital transformation story is playing out as we speak. And every company wants to hire digital talent. And attrition rates are moving up across companies. Salaries are going up like crazy for people with the right skills. Now, this is not happening in all parts of the economy. Like I said, it's only, in some parts, in some industries is where we are seeing this. I don't know if this is going to sustain. But right now, it's almost impossible to hire, people in this market. It's that bad. If in the digital sort of world. In the non-digital world, things are not as rosy.
Got into this. Just one last question. So maybe an extension of one of the previous questions. We already have around 3,600 crore cash on the balance sheet, maybe more than sufficient for any of our future M&A / early stage investment options. So how do we look at the monetization plan from, let us say, a Zomato listing standpoint? Are we going ahead with that monetization of that stake, or because we already have 3,600 crore kind of cash on the balance sheet, what is the thought process behind monetizing that stake in Zomato at this juncture?
Yeah, see, just one point I want to make. See, 3,600 crores is not a lot of money in the digital world anymore, right? You routinely hear of companies in the digital world making $200-300 million acquisitions every day, right? Of companies you've not even heard of. So I'm just letting you know that if you want to make a big acquisition, this money may not be enough. Now, Sanjeev can talk about what we want to do on the with this Zomato stake. Sanjeev, you're on mute.
Sorry. Look, it's there in the DRHP that we will monetize up to 750 crores worth of stock. We stay with that as of now, up to 750 crores. We will, of course, the RHP that we filed, and let's see what happens there.
Sure, sir. Thanks. That's it from my side, and all the best.
Next question is from Satvik from Perennial Fund. So Satvik seems dropped out, so I'll take next question. Next question is from Vivekanand Subramanian from Ambit Capital. Vivekanand, go ahead and ask your question.
Hi. Thank you very much for the opportunity. I have a couple of questions. So one, as you mentioned about a month and a half back that a large part, 20-25% of your employees were also impacted by COVID.
Yes.
So does this second wave, the suddenness and the sharpness, does this change your outlook towards just having one office in NCR? Would you want to change the way you operate? That's question one. Secondly, with respect to the previous question on Zomato, Sanjeev, I heard that you mentioned there is an option to monetize up to 7.5 billion rupees worth of stake.
750 crores, I said.
Right, 750 crores. So, does this necessarily mean that we will need to go ahead with it, or could we potentially not sell?
We have no further announcement to make on this right now. It's in the DRHP that we will monetize up to 750 crores. Let's see how the IPO proceeds.
So, I don't know if I got the first question right, but basically, you were asking whether we will intend to go back to working from one office in Noida, right?
No, my question was more about your operations being, being focused on one city, right? NCR, right? Most of your central teams sit there. Is there a plan to possibly change the way you operate, given how badly NCR was impacted during the second wave? I'm just asking the same question that I asked some time ago on tech hiring being so difficult in NCR. Probably, will you consider being operating from other cities like Bangalore, Pune?
Got it. So listen, so we have close to 4,500 employees. Many of our the employees we have are in sales roles. So we have sales offices in over 40 cities. So I think close to 1,500 people, or maybe 1,200, 1,300 people operate out of these cities, right? And these offices in these cities. In NCR also, we have multiple offices. So we don't operate out of one physical location. Of course, for the last 16, 18 months, we've been operating from home. And that is what we intend to do for the next few months as well, till, this sort of COVID is behind us. It's had no impact on our business. We are doing okay. We see no reason to go back to working from office in a hurry, right? Will we hire remotely? Answer is maybe yes, because the way we are working seems to be working out well for us. Now, will we be very aggressive about remote hiring? Maybe no, to start with, but we will experiment for sure, with remote hiring. Take Zwayam, for example, the company we acquired, they're based out of Bangalore. So now we have a base in Bangalore as well, right? So if you want to, expand our operation in Bangalore, we can always add more people in Bangalore.
Okay, understood. Thank you.
The next question is from Neha Dakhneja. Neha, go ahead and ask your question.
Thank you so much for the opportunity. So my questions are in line with the online matchmaking business that you have, Jeevan Sathi. So where do you see the business going forward from here? And do you see the business being profitable in the coming years? And what are your current marketing spends?
So the plan is to keep growing Jeevan Sathi at 20% plus per annum for the next few years. And now this will require investment, substantial investments in marketing if we have to gain share. So we believe that we'll have to keep investing in the business and mostly in marketing for the next 3-4 years at least. So that's the current plan. I mean, last year we lost 90 crores. Year before last we lost 60 crores. Going forward also we may have to, because the market is very competitive, we are number three. Number two in the north, but number three nationally. If we have to gain share, then we have to match the marketing spends of our competitors, who today are spending 120, 130 crores a year on marketing. So if we have to gain share, we'll have to spend at least that much, if not more.
Do you have plans for consolidations in this market? And where do you see yourself?
No, it's a three-player market, unfortunately. And therefore, no player makes a lot of money. And we are all fighting each other, and prices are also depressed. Pricing is also depressed. So, ideally, it makes a lot of sense for players to sort of come together. But whether it's doable or whether in the next 1 or 2 years is hard for me to say. I mean, we are open to the idea, but it may or may not be practical and feasible.
And will you be on the buying side or the
sell? Yes. We would rather buy than sell.
Okay. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you. Next question is from Krishna from Capital Mind. Krishna, go ahead and ask your question.
Yeah, hi. Good evening and thanks for the opportunity. I just have one question. On our balance sheet, we have 2,329 crores categorized as other financial assets. So can you throw some light on what these assets are actually?
So these are the FDs lying with the banks more than 1 year with original maturity. So one category is up to 3 months, second is 3 to 12 months, and third category is beyond 1 year.
Okay, so these are essentially FDs only.
That's right.
Cash equivalents. Great. Any light on Policy Bazaar IPO? When can we expect it? Maybe year end or next year?
Chintan, want to take that?
So Policy Bazaar is preparing themselves for the IPO. When they will have, I think that's a little far off. Board has not really approved any plans. But we can certainly tell you that they are preparing for it. And as you know, that IPO preparation takes its own amount of time. So I think they are going through that. So as and when we are kind of ready for that and DRHP is filed, I'm sure there will be an announcement on that.
Okay. Thanks for the opportunity.
Yeah, the next question is from Mayank Babla from the Lal and Brosha. Mayank, go ahead and ask your question.
Thank you for taking my question. My first question is about the other expenses. Quarter on quarter, there's been a sudden spike from 15.7 crores to 22.5 crores. Could you please explain that?
Sorry, which other expenses?
Yeah. On the standalone basis.
Sorry. I missed the question.
The other expenses line, the increase.
In the standalone results, yeah. Quarter on quarter increase.
The question is, other expenses have gone up substantially compared to last quarter.
Okay. Hello?
Just give us a minute.
So can I go ahead with the second question to that?
Yeah, please go ahead.
Hitesh sir, my question was around for us, Zomato and Policy Bazaar, it took 8 to 10 years of patient capital to become so big. over the next, now going ahead over the next, 8 to 10 years or 15 years, which segments or which sectors are you seeing, potential in, or where you can, where you seeing it can be the next Zomato or, Policy Bazaar?
Sanjeev, you're on mute.
May I take that question? So look, we don't do it top down. We don't do sectors. We prefer to see companies and entrepreneurs. And if we like something, we invest in it. So we like to see what's bubbling up. We do it bottom up. We believe that's the best way to invest, as opposed to pre-deciding, hey, we've got 4 classified sectors. We don't have automobile. We got to do it. That's not the way we do it. Okay. Now, if I talk about companies that are promising, I think in the direct investments that Infoedge has made from its balance sheet or its subsidiary balance sheets, there are, I think, 2 or 3 companies that are looking promising, right? But of course, they're much, much smaller and much, much less valuable than Zomato and Policy Bazaar right now. So these would be a Gramophone, a Shop Kirana, a Shipsy, a business, right? We are hopeful that 1 or 2 more may emerge, which will be really valuable. But look, with early stage, you can't say for sure. We would love all 5 or 6 to make it. But, our past experience tells us that, look, if you've got 6 promising, in all likelihood, not all 6 will make it. So wait and watch. And we continue to support, continue to invest, continue to work with them. As far as the AIF portfolio is concerned, that's very, very new. So it's too early. It's still emerging. But yeah, we've got some promising investments there also, but it's emerging. As far as the investments in the strategic spaces are concerned, which is investments in jobs, in real estate, in matrimony, and in education classifieds, the consideration there is not necessarily to build unicorns, or invest in unicorns and have this great financial upside there. I think a big part of that intent would be to complete your offering, to build your moat, to tackle a new segment. And so you've got to look at it from that strategic prism. So for example, the Zoyam acquisition, on its own may or may not become a unicorn or a separate business, but does it complete the offering of Naukri? For example, does it make your job listings product much more useful because it's enterprise response management service? Maybe it does. What does IIM Jobs do? Does it complete a gap in your portfolio? Yes, it probably does. Now, will it become a 1,000-crore business on its own? May not be. But does it cover a gap in the market which builds a moat around Naukri? Answer is yes, possibly. Thanks. So the prism for evaluating strategic investments is different from merely valuations.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
And other expenses have increased because of CSR spend, exactly, which has increased, and also for bad debts, basically, primarily.
Okay. Thank you so much. Thank you.
The next question is from Kaushal Shah. Kaushal, go ahead and ask your question.
Hi. Am I audible?
Yeah, go ahead.
Do you look any competition coming from LinkedIn or any big thing in professional networking in your recruitment vertical? And again, one question, as Hitesh said, that you are not willing to give back any money via dividend. So any bonus plans on your list? Thank you.
See, LinkedIn has been around for maybe 12, 14 years. We've been competing with LinkedIn. Has anything changed on that front? Has anything material sort of happened on that front, which we would want to report? The answer is no. We continue to compete with LinkedIn like we've been competing for the last few years.
Oh, okay. And
as far as the bonus issue is concerned, look, we haven't discussed it really, but my personal sense is that, look, you will be prepared to give a bonus when your EPS is high enough and there's predictability. Now, given COVID and the uncertain environment, there isn't so much predictability, and therefore, which is why we haven't considered it so far. It's not even been discussed.
Okay. Thank you.
Next question is from Vivekanand from Ambit Capital. Vivekanand, go ahead and ask your question.
Yeah, hi. Thank you for the follow-up opportunity. So, Hitesh, Sanjeev, would you like to share any update on the recruitment areas or segments where we are not that dominant, especially the non-IT side or BFSI And if you could give us a bit more qualitative color on the kind of customers that IIM Jobs and IRIS have signed on. That's question one. Second, we were talking about the management reorganization, I think in fiscal 20 end or mid of fiscal 20, mid of fiscal 19, with respect to the real estate vertical, where we wanted to focus on few new revenue segments. Any update on that?
Yeah. Okay. So let me take your question on IIM Jobs and Hirist and segments where we are not as strong. See, basically, Naukri is a dominant player across segments. So whether it's IT companies or non-IT companies, every company uses Naukri to hire. IT companies, of course, hire a lot of people and they see a lot more value in Naukri. It's a lot of hiring is skill-based. But where Naukri and where LinkedIn comes in is where LinkedIn is sort of used for more passive hiring, you know, of hiring of seekers who are not looking for a job, where Naukri used to be used more for active job seeker hiring or of job seekers who were looking for jobs. And that continues to be the case. Now, where IIM Jobs made some inroads was in management hiring. So hiring of, management graduates from good institutions, premier institutions, which companies like, for example, if you take some of the top companies in India, they hire a lot of, they go to the best sort of these schools, they hire from those schools, they do a lot of campus hiring. They hire very high quality talent from the IIMs, the other sort of good business schools. And that's where Naukri was lagging a bit. Because see, while Naukri had all these jobs and they had all these job seekers, you know, because we had a lot of them, the premium guys were getting lost, right, on the platform. And IIM Jobs had built a good brand in this segment. So we managed to use IIM Jobs to get a lot of these customers who were not using Naukri aggressively for hiring this kind of talent into our fold. Right? That's been the effort till now. Hirus is still tiny. Okay, Hirus is still very, very small compared to IIM Jobs and compared to Naukri. But it's emerging as a decent tech brand. Again, our intention will be, but we'll have to see how it plays out in real life, will be to position Hirus as a premium tech hiring brand, unlike Naukri, which is like a mass tech hiring brand. So that let's see how that goes. Early days on that front.
There's the right? Second part of the question.
Second was on, 99 Acres management reorganization. Yeah, yeah. So we are, earlier we used to look at 99 Acres as one business with one team managing everything. So over time we realized that, we are actually in maybe three or four different verticals in the real estate business. So the jobs, the resale vertical is very different from the commercial vertical, which is very different from the new home vertical, which is very different from the rental vertical, right? So what we've done, at least for the time being, is we've reorganized a product team, at least. So we have separate teams working on each of these verticals. So separate platform teams for each of these verticals. We are now moving towards, reorganizing the engineering team also, platform-wise or vertical-wise. Right now, we have one sales team which sells to all our customers. But there also, we have, separated out the new home piece to a large extent so that we have a separate set of people who work on customers who sell new homes, right? So it's largely done. We are 60-70% there. We continue to, of course, have one brand, 99 Acres. We are not launching separate brands right now. That's not the intent. But that's where we are on that journey.
Thanks a lot. Any comments on the debate? This is a perennial debate with respect to 99 Acres, the debate between remaining a classified player and a full stack operation. And secondly, do you have anything to report in respect to the collaboration with some of the investees that operate in the same area? You had made those investments a couple of years ago.
Yeah. So, full stack versus classified. See, of course, classified is our core business and we are primarily a listing and marketing platform. And that's where 95%, 98% of revenue comes from today. About maybe 1 or 2% of our revenue today comes from services we provide to owners, right? And yes, the plan is to grow this piece over time, faster if possible, to provide more and more assisted services to owners. Are we looking to go the whole hog and become brokers? Definitely not in the resale segment, definitely not in the rental segment, right? I mean, that's not the current plan. Could we invest in companies outside which do stuff like this? Maybe we could, but that's... maybe we experimented with all check deals a few years ago and we then shut it down. So all check deals were supposed to be like a channel partner for selling new homes. It did not work out for us at that point in time. Could we revisit that idea? Maybe we could at some point in time. Let's see. Let's see how it evolves. Not saying no. We've invested, like you said, we've invested in a couple of startups in the real estate space outside. Teal is one of them. It's a real estate analytics company. We're trying out some integration with Teal right now in 99 acres, early days. So nothing much to report on that front. The other investment we made is in Rahul Yadav's company, but that is very, very recent. So again, not much to report on that front.
Thank you very much.
Any more questions, please? This was the last question we had for today. So the next question is from Hari. Hari, go ahead and ask your question.
Hello, sir. Thank you for taking my question. My question is on Jeevan Sathi. So this year, we have, I think, burnt 93 crores. Last year, so we burnt 65 crores. And I think if we sum up for the last 5 years, I think we have burnt around 220 or 230 odd crores. So I was just wondering, from the outside in, it doesn't seem like a super exciting market that's growing very quickly. So what is that we are seeing in this market that we are continuing to invest so much money here?
Well, see, we are a really strong player now in the north. We are a strong number two in the Indy belt. We have close to 40% share. Why we are spending this much money right now is to gain share, right? And we've gained share over the last few years. We believe that if we keep investing this kind of money for the next 2-3 years, we, become a leader in the north, and hopefully at some point in time, there'll be consolidation in the space. So that's the idea right now. Why are we spending this much money? Because our competition is also spending a lot of money. So we are also forced to spend. It's a competitive market. If we don't, then of course, then it's like exiting the market. But I do believe that this market can grow, continue to grow at 15-20% per annum or 15-17% per annum for the next few years. It's not, and if there was to ever be consolidation in the space, then, the margins also could be healthy, for the players who are left in the business.
I understood. That's super helpful. Thank you.
Next question is from Swapnil from JM Financial. Swapnil, go ahead and ask your question. Swapnil, you are there?
Hello. Can you hear me?
Yeah, please go ahead.
Yeah, a couple of questions actually. One is with respect to the merger of iimjobs with the standalone business. So is that complete? And going ahead, will you be reporting the numbers as a merged entity? And second question is a bit on your investment strategy with respect to the investing portfolio. So in the food delivery space, we have Zomato as an investment, and you also have invested in DotPay, which in a way cater to the same category of, they address the same problem actually, which is delivery of food to the customers, and they are in a way competitors to each other. So any thoughts on any rationale behind these investments, and how do you look to these investments from your perspective? Thank you.
If you want to answer the first part first.
Let me answer the first part. So we are in the process of carrying out the legal integration. We are in the midst of it. We have had our shareholders meeting and creditors meeting. The second motion is also passed. Probably somewhere in July, mid, or maybe in August, I think the legal merger should be complete. And after that, it will become part of STEM.
As far as DotPay is concerned, it is not just a restaurant billing or improvised billing, remote billing app, contactless billing app. It's a horizontal play. One use case is restaurants, but there are going to be several other use cases. So as the company evolves, we'll see more and more of this happening. But yes, caught the media attention, and there have been a couple of articles, is because NRAI is pushing DotPay and promoting it and as an alternative. But no, DotPay does not deliver. They do not have a delivery fleet. DotPay is a contactless billing app, and it'll deliver you the menu card, and you can do it.
Right. Thank you.
The next question is from Nancy Desai from Marklis. Nancy, go ahead and ask your question.
Sorry, so this is Salil from Marklis. Thanks, Anand.
Okay.
So the question is, any thoughts on how the blue collar hiring space is shaping up, and if say the two COVID waves had any impact on the way hiring takes place in this segment, and what would be your strategy to play here?
So we've been test marketing a product job hai in the NCR market for the last few months. Results have been encouraging. Early days, but clearly what has changed in the last few years is that everybody has a smartphone and as people have become digitally savvy. So it's very easy to get job seekers in the blue collar space onto your app, onto your platform. The harder part is actually getting the SMEs to use the platform to hire, which is what we've been working on. But I think that will also sort of become easier. Once you know SMEs also start digitizing, that will also become easier. So I think fundamentally, now, is there a viable business there? Is it possible to make money? Time will tell. But yes, I think the market is ready for blue collar hiring. I mean, for a blue collar business now. Of course, there's a lot of competition. But like I said, we've sort of been test marketing in Delhi, NCR. We are happy with the results. Right now, we're not focusing on revenue. We're basically trying to get the product market fit right. And once we are confident, then we will roll it out nationally as well, which I expect to happen over the next few months.
And just to clarify, you're saying the supply side is fine. Is the demand side that is where the problem is?
Yes.
Okay. So that's an interesting problem to have. I mean,
yeah.
It's a better problem. Okay. Great. Thanks a lot.
Yeah, the next question is from Manik Jagtiani. Please go ahead and ask your question, Manik.
Hi, good evening. It's very nice to talk to all of you again. There was just a small question. It's probably a little off the real subject. You know, there's the whole retail market of a lot of investors who would like to invest in InfoEdge, but it's at 5,000 rupees, it's not really within the reach of a whole lot of retail investors. So has there been any plan or is there any idea at all that you would like to split the stock and make it more accessible to the broader market?
Okay, we haven't discussed this, but look, it's a thank you for the suggestion. We will certainly at least discuss it. I'm not sure, saying we'll do it, but at least we'll discuss it. Whether it's a bonus or it's a stock split, we'll have to just figure out, or maybe do nothing. Let's see. But thank you.
Thank you.
Next question is from Arnav Kapoor. Arnav, go ahead and ask your question.
Thank you. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Thanks for the opportunity. I just wanted to understand, you know, given that we have so many B2C and also B2B businesses, and given the trend around, you know, super app, you know, which has been working in China and many corporates and large corporates in India trying to replicate, given that, you know, we work on the spectrum of, you know, basically the entire life cycle of a human being, do you see an opportunity to integrate them, even though they're investments in different companies and strategic investments, and some of them are our own, to build that kind of an ecosystem? Where, you know, you are able to monetize, cross-leverage, cross-sell, upsell across the various businesses. That's it. Thank you.
No, I mean, to answer your question, there is no such plan. We don't think, you know, given the nature of our businesses, which are sort of, you know, life events actually in the lives of most people, it's not as if people are on our platform every day of their lives or on one of our platforms every day. We don't think they sort of lend themselves to the idea of a super app. And we would therefore rather sort of let each business figure out its own strategy rather than distract them and sort of get them to work, you know, together, you know, at the back end. So, I mean, we've discussed this several times in the past, but it's not on the agenda. And by the way, in my view, it's very, very hard to build a super app. thanks, for anybody, thanks. Not just for us.
Oh, thanks. I totally agree. I mean, there could be just opportunities in cross-selling, yeah. like in insurance yeah. And other things which you can come from building a database. Thanks so much. The other question was answered on.
You know, Google. Actually, I just commented that. See, sure. In the past, you know, we also thought, you know, you can sell, in your resume form in Naukri who's single, who's married, because you pick up that data. So maybe you can sell Jeevansathi services. But when we actually tried to promote it, when we acquired Jeevansathi first, right, and we tried to promote it, people got mad at us. So although we're technically allowed to do it, we have the rights, we stopped doing it. The truth is, when you're looking for a job, you're not looking for a house and you're not looking for a spouse. No, it's about, even though your demographic may be the same, and it's about what you're looking for when you're looking for it. So, cross-selling is harder than it sounds, is what we have learned.
Thanks for that answer. Thank you.
So in case there are more questions, please raise your hand. That was the last for the moment. So Vivek, there are no more questions coming in. So you want to take it ahead?
So on behalf of InfoEdge, we conclude this.
One question has come, sorry. So I may take it that, yeah. So question is from Ajay Tyagi. Ajay, go ahead and ask your question.
Hello. Yeah, just one quick question. We've been hearing about the fact that even the private sector will have to post their jobs on a government portal now. Can you throw some color on that? Is that expected to have any impact on our business?
Not really. We've been hearing stuff like this for the last 15 years. It's not really materialized till now. And of course, every state has its own sort of plan. And we continue to engage with some of these governments. Now, it's possible that some sort of states may take it more seriously than other states. But right now, we don't see any impact on our business. And I guess if they do it, they'll probably do it for blue-collar jobs.
Where did you pick this up from?
I think it was there in some of the newspapers recently.
Okay.
Over the years, we've engaged with many state governments on subjects like these. I mean, nothing's ever materialized. And my sense is, whenever we engage with them, they're more focused on the idea of, blue-collar job seekers and sort of helping them get jobs than on white-collar sort of job seekers.
Sure. No, it was. I think in one of the dailies, maybe Sanjeev, I'll forward that to you just to see if it's again
thanks so much. Yeah.
One of those things which has been happening on and off, or is there anything more tangible?
Actually, in many many states, there already is a law that if you have any vacancy, it's mandatory to notify the local employment exchange. But right. Nobody does it because they don't see too much value in doing it, and the government does not go after them. So that seems to be an archaic provision, which is there, but is not used or implemented. But, different states are different, and who knows, tomorrow's a new day.
And, by the way, in the past, we've also helped state governments put some of these platforms together. I don't want to name them, but we worked with a couple of them to sort of help them also. But for some reason, these things have never taken off.
Right. Sure. Thanks.
We have one more question from Zara, FedVintage. Zara, go ahead and ask your question.
Hello.
Yeah, please.
Yeah, sorry, I was on mute. Can you hear me?
Yeah, please go ahead.
Yeah, so I had a couple of questions. When you think of your core business, is it just the verticals you're in right now, or are you open to the larger universe, if you will, of the classifieds business? Like, are you open to other segments?
Yeah, so right now we are mostly focused on the segments we are in, which we think are very, very large. So we, jobs and careers, for example, is a large category. We mostly play in the white collar job seeker space. We are now beginning to look at blue collar. We begin to look at ATSs, recruitment software, recruitment services. But right now, most of our business comes from the white collar sort of sourcing space. Similarly, 99acres, like I mentioned earlier, we are now beginning to look at 99acres as four different verticals. You know, the rental business is very different from the resale business. The resale business is very different from new homes. It's very different from commercial. In Shiksha, which is our education business, we've started a study abroad sort of business within the Shiksha business, which is a separate sort of game altogether. So I think in the verticals we operate, there are sort of many opportunities which we would rather go after first. But we are not close to the idea of starting a fifth vertical, especially if we understand the space. So classified is something we understand and appreciate, you know, and we know we can run classified businesses. So if a good opportunity comes our way in the classified sort of space, we will definitely evaluate it.
So if you were looking at it, you know, when you say that's your specialized skill, if you will, how does that actually translate for a new space, if at all it had to? Like, you know, if you were looking at a space, what are the sort of necessary conditions, if you will, for a classifieds business to succeed, you know?
Do you want to complete your question?
No, because, you know, like some of the business, I mean, you know, in fact, most of the businesses that you're in your classified space, you know, they are growing at a certain scale, at a certain rate, if you will, and they've always been sort of markets of scale, right? But it's not like you're able to rush the pace of growth beyond a point.
Yeah.
And organic and a nice, slow and steady, not slow, but like relatively speaking, compared to the size, it has been your style forever. So I'm just sort of, you know, trying to understand just that. And, you know, is it inherent in the nature of classifieds for it to not be pushed to grow beyond a point? And also, like I said, you know, what would be the necessary conditions, if you will, when looking at another space?
So every category is different. So let's take jobs, for example. Now, if India starts growing at whatever, 7-8% per annum for the next few years, the Naukri business could start growing at 30-40% per annum. Right. I mean, we are already seeing that kind of growth, for example, in IT, right? Because IT markets are hot right now.
Right.
So, you know, it's not as if classified business cannot grow at.
I've been sort of tracking your company since you listed at some level. So I understand that. I'm just sort of, trying to sort of understand, you know, I mean, you can. It does not constrain your ability to grow in other areas, is what I'm trying to get at. And therefore, if you're looking at other markets.
So we are not, we are not actively considering entering other sort of verticals right now. Like I said, we are more focused on entering adjacent verticals, adjacent to the ones we already operate in right now. So we would rather do a careers platform than do a car portal. We would rather do, you know, spend more time and money on building a rental platform inside 99acres than something else.
So when you say Dan, why are you rejecting it? Is it simply because you feel that the bandwidth you have is adequate only to cater to what you're in right now? Or is it because, you know, you keep saying cars, but, you know, cars is probably more sort of from a capital allocation perspective is not the kind of business you'd be in. So I'm just wondering if there's an evaluation criteria there, or is it just, no, let's stick to adjacent stuff.
No. So we are not, like I said, we're not close to the idea. But see, two or three things have to happen, have to sort of be in place before we start a fifth vertical. One is that, you know, the market should be large, addressable market should be large. We don't want to enter into too many small markets. Two, you know, we don't want to have, I mean, it's very, very hard to displace an incumbent, if the incumbent is already very, very strong. So we would not want to enter markets where there are strong sort of players already, right? Okay. And, you know, and any space we enter into, we should have something unique to offer to the customer. You know, something unique, something relevant, which others are not doing. Otherwise, it doesn't make any sense. So the truth is that, you know, there are lots of startups today and they're all trying a bunch of things. Most regular or sort of, categories are already taken. There are already, established players and they've been at it for a while and they're pumping in tons of money. Okay. So for us to enter a new category, like I said, the offering has to be unique. The market has to be large. We have to be early. There should not be too many established players because that makes it virtually impossible. So these criteria have to be met for us before we start a fifth vertical.
Okay. All right, fair enough. That's helpful. Thanks. And just on the other side, on the investment, the AIF fund, or just wondering if, you know, this is, I know it's again very early days, and you've talked about how you need patient capital and it takes 10 years to build a business, but are you all really looking at possibly having a venture fund business as a vertical sometime in the future?
Well,
8 years out?
Look, the AIF is a venture fund business. It's just that we only got two LPs. Okay.
Sorry.
So we only got two LPs. That's Info Edge and Temasek. Right.
Right. But is
as of now, the thinking is that we are unlikely to go down the path of raising larger and larger funds with 20 LPs and 10 LPs and 30 LPs. We're happy with one like-minded LP in addition to Info Edge, where both are patient, both are perpetual capital, both have a long-term view in India. So, see, if you look at historically, exits in early stage investments in India have been hard and difficult. So, if you leave out Flipkart, strategic sales have not happened at any kind of valuation which will give investors a lot of joy and will return the whole fund or something, right? That doesn't happen.
Right.
And from early stage, from first check to IPO, often takes 12, 13, 15 years.
Right.
We were the fastest at 6 years, and we were good and lucky. I think Make My Trip took 10 years. I think Just Dial would have taken about 17, 18, 20 years. I think IndiaMART took about maybe 20 years. I think Matrimony took 20 years. So, you've got to have really patient capital. Now, if your regular venture fund is 8 plus 2 years, it doesn't cover the distance from first check to IPO. And therefore, venture funds in India, very many of them have had a hard time, if they invest early stage, in getting great exits. And that's not so easy. Which is why our fund is 12 plus 2 years. And which is why our fund only has two LPs, and both have a long-term view in India. So tomorrow, if you don't want to exit at the end of 14 years, then you can just devolve the shares to the LPs, if the assets are good.
Yeah, no, I get that, Sanjeev. But I just wanted to know if, what happens 5 years later? Or, just what is the, if at all there is, this is still just the first fund and you will see how it plays out? Or is there some kind of, within the framework that you've created in terms of, 8 plus 2 is not enough? And, so on your terms, but... is there an intent to then venture into that space, or is it always
We have already ventured into the space.
In terms of growth.
Look. The intent is obviously we will like to do more funds should the experience be good.
Okay. All right. Fair enough. All right. Thank you. That's it from my end. Thanks.
The next question is from Arpit Shah from Stalin. Arpit, go ahead and ask your question.
Hello, sir. This is Amit Jiswani here for Arpit Shah. So my question is about the reinvestment. We're sitting on 3,000 crores of cash on books, and we've not been able to reinvest. The opportunity, Corona is now coming to an end, hopefully, and yet we're not able to reinvest the cash flows. The interest that we would be getting with 5% yields about 150 crores. We'll be getting 750 from Zomato. Your cash next year will be near 4,000 crores. Keeping in FDs is not good capital allocation. What is our capital allocation strategy, and how are we not? How are we controlling our FOMO when other people are making so much money?
Chintan, you want to address that? I think Hitesh already addressed it, but let's have your version now.
So look, cash has always been central to our strategy, right? We can use it as a defensive strategy. We can also use it as an offensive strategy. Last year, when we went ahead and did the QIP, the thinking about raising money, about trying to do an inorganic growth, has always been there in past 2-3 years inside the organization. We have been thinking about it. We have been preparing ourselves for it, right? And accordingly, it was not so much about COVID, but that thinking was already there. So we went ahead and we raised money. And we are still open. We have kind of sent out the messages saying that, yes, we do want to look at the large acquisition
if that happens in any of the four verticals that we operate in, we are happy to look at it. We are also happy to look at it, some of the strategic minority stake in adjacencies or any of the differentiated business model, which can help us to readdress the market that we are addressing, or kind of, you know, create some kind of synergies with, you know, with the product that we are offering, or create more modes for our businesses. We are open to look at that as well. Now, as you know that, you know, this type of strategic, you know, investments or acquisition does take time, and we have been saying that we need to be patient about it. So that's what it is all about, you know. So certainly we are, you know, open to look at the, you know, the ideas, and we are open to look at the inorganic growth opportunities, and that's why we are keeping the capital.
So Chintanji, just one question. Since like we've seen companies like Baiju on the edtech space, which you are present in. They have scaled up well. You've got so many startups which are like something which is outside your space, something like Dream 11. What is stopping us to buy in these unicorns as well? Like, what is our thinking behind it? Do we want to make this 50, 100 crore acquisitions, or we are open to 100, $200 million acquisitions as well? Just I want to understand the reinvestment strategy exactly.
So look, as long as anything is around our four key verticals that we are operating in, no, it could be an early stage or it could be later stage, right? As long as it makes sense and the asset is good. Again, I'm saying that the idea of raising money was not to look at some distressed asset and do some kind of financial arbitrage and gain value out of it. But it's all about how do we can build strong businesses. And each of these categories that we operate in, we think that in the long run, they are all large, you know, multi-billion kind of categories. And, you know, we want to gain leadership in that. If something is going to help us to gain leadership in these four verticals, we are open to look at it. As earlier Hitesh also indicated, we are not close to the fifth vertical idea, but that's right now not on the table.
So just last one question, sorry. What is our expected IRR on the 3,000 crores of cash that we already hold, and probably 4,000 crores next year if we don't invest? So what is the IRR we investors should expect from that kind? Like, what's your expected IRR on the reinvestments that you have right now, the cash that we are sitting on?
It depends what we do with it, right? If we actually deploy it to buy assets or to invest in companies or to invest in our internal business, there is be one IRR. Now, quite honestly, that's a hard spreadsheet to pull off because it'll be fiction. We can write any number, it'll be fiction. Right now, however, if you don't utilize it, it'll be fixed dollar IRR, which is whatever post-tax 3-3.5%. I don't know what it is.
Got it, sir. Thank you so much. I wish you all the luck.
So that was the last after a gap of many questions. So we may wait for a minute or so in case there are any questions, else we'll wrap it up. Yeah. We have one question. Okay. So next question is from Anirudh. Anirudh, go ahead and ask your question.
Yeah, I just wanted to check. Do you have anything in the healthcare vertical?
We have invested in one company called Medcords from the balance sheet, which is into rural healthcare. We keep looking at healthcare, but healthcare, you know, it's a hard business model. Most business model in healthcare we're still trying to figure out how they'll make money, how will they be financially viable. And when we see something good, we'll do it. So it's not as if we are close to it, but we haven't made a big, big, deep foray into healthcare just yet.
Thank you.
So we don't have any more questions as of now.
I'd like to add one more thing. We have also made an investment from the AIF in a company called TrueMeds, healthcare, it's a pharmaceutical distribution company.
So with this last question, on behalf of InfoEdge, we conclude this conference. Thank you everyone for joining in. You may now disconnect your lines.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Bye-bye.
Thank you, everyone, and have a good evening.
Thank you.